Yeah, okay, very good. All right. Okay. good morning, everyone. It is my great honor to introduce the 2016 Shannon Lecture presented by this year's Shannon Award winner, Professor Alexander Holevo. Professor Holevo received the award yesterday afternoon, as most of you have seen, and as some of you may have even heard. And although he is extremely prolific, his biography has not changed much since then, so I will be brief. He graduated from Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology in 1966, and since 1969, he has worked at the Steklov Mathematical Institute in Moscow, where he heads the Department of Probability and Mathematical Statistics. Professor Holevo's distinguished work has covered diverse aspects of probability, information theory, and mathematical physics. His many achievements include the foundation of non-commutative statistical decision theory, the investigation of the structure of quantum Markov processes, and various aspects of quantum communication and computation. For his outstanding work, Professor Holevo received many awards, including the International Quantum Communication Award, the von Humboldt Research Award, four times the Russian Academy of Sciences Best Research Award, and the Markov Prize. The Markov Prize, by the way, is distinguished from all other awards in that typical prize committees maintain a standing pool of prospective winners that they consider over time. By contrast, the Markov Prize committee every year discards all previous candidates and selects the next year's winner completely independently. Professor Holevo is a pioneer of quantum theory. He started his work on the topic shortly after receiving his PhD and was the first to establish rigorous results on quantum communication or computation. In 1973, he proved what is known as Holevo's theorem, upper bounding the classical capacity of a quantum channel with unentangled inputs. 14 years later, he also proved that this bound was achievable. And interestingly, of these 14 years, two were due to IT transactions publication delay. It took well over a decade for other researchers to catch on with additional results, but since then, Holevo and his many followers have made numerous quantum communication and computation contributions, and consequently, today, quantum technology is a major topic in academia, as we know, in industry, where, for example, you can now use IBM's small quantum computer online, and even amongst head of states. Video, please.
I was going to ask you to explain quantum computing, but when do you expect Canada's ISIL mission to begin again? And are we not doing anything in the interim while we prepare?
Okay. Very simply, normal computers work by... Don't interrupt me. When you walk out of here, you will know more. Well, no, some of you will know far less about quantum computing, but most of you. Normal computers work either there's power going through a wire or not. It's one or a zero. They're binary systems. What quantum states allow for is much more complex information to be encoded into a single bit. Regular computer bit is either a one or a zero, on or off. A quantum state can be much more complex than that because, as we know, things can be both particle and wave at the same times, and the uncertainty around quantum states allows us to encode more information into a much smaller computer. So that's what's exciting about quantum computing, and that's what we're looking for. Don't get me going on this, or we'll be here all day, trust me.
Thanks. Thank you. And the person who helped start it all is here with us, the 2016 Shannon Award winner. Please welcome Professor Alexander Holevo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the nice introduction, even movie. The subject of my lecture was chosen for two reasons. The field of quantum information theory is already vast field, but this is my favorite topic. And second, it is intermediate between classical and quantum information. And I think for this reason, it is suitable for, as an invitation for people, those who are not familiar with quantum theory. So the beginning of quantum communication dates back to end of 50s, beginning of 60s, when researchers started to ask about fundamental limits for information transmission. And I give an incomplete list of names of pioneers who were working at that time, trying to understand the limits, quantum limits. Perhaps Dennis Gabor, the inventor of holography and Nobel Prize winner for that, was the first to pose the question of fundamental quantum limitations. But soon after, at the end of the 60s, beginning of 70s, the need for genuine quantum communication, quantum Shannon theory, became evident. And it was the time when I entered the subject, between 60s and 70s. The concepts used by quantum information theory, on one hand, they are similar to concepts of classical information theory. It is entropy, but it is von Neumann entropy rather than Shannon entropy. Typicality, but typicality of subspaces rather than sequences. Then there is the notion of channel, which will be discussed in great detail in my lecture. The notion of capacity, but here there are many capacities of quantum channel. I will speak only about one basic capacity. And also there is a concept which is entirely absent in the classical case, specifically quantum Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen correlations called entanglement. I also will speak about that. And mathematical tools which are used in quantum information theory are also essentially probabilistic and in some sense combinatorial, but along with classical analysis and probability, one heavily uses non-commutative analysis and probability, that is operator and matrix algebra, random matrices, etc. Now let me recall the motto of Mark Katz, who told once that probability theory is a measure theory with a soul. And similarly, one can say that quantum information theory is a matrix or operator theory, but with a soul given by statistical interpretation of quantum mechanics. And in my lecture, I will try to stress parallels between classical and quantum case and stress the common algebraic structure of both theories to make quantum case more accessible. On the other hand, there are, of course, basic difference between the two theories, and I think they can be briefly expressed in two words, complementarity and entanglement. And I will explain what does it mean. The content of my lecture is the following. First, we discuss in parallel quantum and classical statistical descriptions of physical experiments. Then, consider classical quantum channel and give formulation of some result, both historical and even some very recent results, a brief survey of results concerning classical quantum channels. Then I will pass to the general concept of quantum channel and the relevant classical capacity of quantum channel. And we'll briefly touch upon famous additivity problem, which concerns this capacity. Then I pass to more recent topic of quantum Gaussian channels, and we'll report on some results, giving a solution for quantum analog of famous Shannon capacity formula for Gaussian channels. This is a question which was open for about 10 years. And at the end, I will very briefly comment on other capacities of quantum channel other than the classical capacity. This is my plan. Statistical descriptions. So in each physical experiment, one has two basic stages. First stage is preparation of state. After state of a system is prepared, it is transferred to measuring device, and the second stage is measurement of some observable. I put channel in parentheses because for a moment it will be ideal channel, so it's you strictly prepare, then measure, and then you get output data. As a rule, output data are random data, therefore you need statistical description. Thus, the result of such an experiment is a probability distribution, which depends on two independent stages, state S and observable X. This is duality. And I will explain in more detail both classical and quantum case. Classical description, it is more or less obvious. Classical state is nothing but probability distribution on a finite alphabet which plays a role of phase space of the system in question. And among all states, pure states, that is degenerate distributions, are most important. They are just one-dimensional projections. In classical observables are nothing but random variables, and I will speak about real-valued variables, random variables only. And among all observables, events, which are characterized by this idempotency condition, are most important. These are just characteristic functions of events. And the duality between state and observable is given by this sum, which is expectation of observable X in the state P, is given by this simple expression. Now it comes a simple, very simple trick, which makes transition to quantum case more smooth. Let us arrange both states and observables like diagonal matrices with these numbers on the diagonal. Then the duality form can be written just a trace of product of two diagonal matrices, one representing state, classical state, and the other representing observable. So trace always replaces sum in our theory. And of course, most basic example is a random bit when you have just two letters in the alphabet. And now we are ready to pass to the quantum description. In quantum case, quantum state is what is called density matrix. It is Hermitian complex valued matrix, which is non-negative definite and have unit trace. In the case it is diagonal, it is just a classical state, but it need not be diagonal. Similarly, pure quantum states are characterized by this projection condition, and it's not difficult to show that they are just one-dimensional projectors onto unit vectors in the corresponding vector space. Now, quantum observables, if we want to speak about analog of random variables with real values, we should take arbitrary Hermitian matrix which has real eigenvalues. And a postulate of quantum mechanics is that when you measure quantum observable, one of possible result is one of eigenvalues of this observable. And among all observables, like in the classical case, you distinguish quantum events These are just projection operators, projections onto some subspaces in the underlying vector space. The duality given by expectation of quantum observable X in the state S, it is just the same expression, trace of density matrix by the matrix, Hermitian matrix, describing quantum observable. And from this, you can derive more detailed description of the outcome of statistical experiment, quantum statistical experiment. You can derive that, probability distribution of observable X in the state S, probability that it takes eigenvalue X as a result of measurement is given by trace of product of density matrix by projection on the eigenspace corresponding to this eigenvalue. And again, a basic example here is quantum bit, or qubit for short, which describes any two-level system like electron spin or polarization of monochromatic photon or atom with two active levels. So these are parallels. And graphically, you can look upon classical and quantum entities as two extreme cases. In classical case, everything is diagonal. In quantum, you can have arbitrary Hermitian matrix. And of course, they have a common parent, which is von Neumann algebras of operators in a Hilbert space, which is much more general object, which can combine both classical and quantum features, and which can live in infinite dimensional space if you need, but we don't need it in this lecture. Now I come from parallels in description to differences. And first, difference, basic difference of quantum description is complementarity. Quantum observables may be incompatible when they do not commute. If they commute, they are called compatible, and physically this means that they are jointly measurable, because commuting matrices can be represented as functions of one single matrix Z, Hermitian matrix Z. So you can think that you measure observable Z in quantum way, and then you classically compute two different functions, F and G. They are jointly measurable. On the other hand, non-commuting observables are called complementary. And what does it mean physically? Why it arises in quantum world and not in classical world? It is because physical measurement on microobject are implemented by macroscopic devices like huge accelerators, such devices, they require very specific organization of space and time. And if you have two different such organizations, you may simply cannot make them together. They may be mutually exclusive, despite they measure quantities of one and the same quantum object, one and the same quantum particle. This means complementarity. And in classical case, everything is compatible. You don't have this feature. Next promised difference is entanglement. Entanglement appears in description of composite systems, which consist of several parts. Let us, for simplicity, consider system of two parts. So in the classical case, trivially, we have such a description for a dependent system, Cartesian product of partial marginal probability distributions, while in the quantum case, two independent systems, one in the state S1, the other in the state S2, is described by tensor or Kronecker product of these two matrices. In classical case, correlated system is arbitrary joint distribution, and in the quantum case, is arbitrary matrix which has double indices for both for rows and for columns. First index refers to first subsystem, second to second subsystem, and similarly here. Then you can define partial states as a partial traces of this matrix. With respect either to second system, then you obtain partial state of first system, and similarly for the second system. So this is a statistical description of a composite system. And now appears entanglement. While in the classical case, arbitrary probability distribution can be obtained as a probabilistic mixture of independent systems of product distributions, it is not so in the quantum case. And the quantum state is called classically correlated or separable if it is representable in a similar way with the tensor product here. So if it is a mixture, probabilistic mixture of tensor product states. Otherwise, it is called entangled. It's not a constructive definition, but to give you an idea, a typical example of entangled states is a projection onto a genuine superposition of different state vectors. And dually, there are also entangled observables. These are observables which cannot be reduced in any natural way to product observables referring only to first and second subsystem. I will not go into detail here. And to describe in words, entanglement is just a specific kind of statistical dependence between the subsystems of quantum system, which does not reduce to classical correlation. And practically, it arises from quantum interaction between the parts of composite system. So these are the basic differences. Now I come to classical quantum channel. We can consider state preparation, which depends on the input signal. So here X is just a letter, which, for example, can have binary nature, 0, 1. And this classical signal is encoded into density matrix, quantum states, by a preparation device. This is just what is called classical quantum channel. Then you may make the following experiment. To assume you don't know the value of X, you want to estimate it by measuring some observable Y. And if you have a random signal, in this case, if you consider the whole this diagram, it is just a classical channel from X to Y. If you fix observable which you measure. And in 1964, Gordon put the following question. If we compute the Shannon mutual information between X and Y, is it true that it is upper bounded by this quantity, which also looks like mutual information, but with quantum entropy instead? It is output entropy of the classical quantum channel, and this is conditional output entropy. So instead of Shannon entropy, here is a von Neumann entropy, which can be expressed as Shannon entropy of eigenvalue distribution of density operator. Now, this was proved by myself in 1973 with two important additions. Besides that, we indeed always have an inequality. We have a strict inequality in the case when at least two of these states do not commute, which means that if If this classical quantum channel infects quantum at the output. So there is a strict inequality here. And another extension was the following, that this inequality is valid not only for measurement of usual observables, but also for measurement of so-called generalized observables, or measurements, like they called. This is the following. This is just what is called quantum classical channel. It is a linear mapping from quantum states to probability distribution. And it's not difficult to show that any such mapping is expressed in such trace formula, where MY is a collection of Hermitian non-negative operators summing to identity operator. So it's operatorial generalization of probability distribution, which is called in mathematics probability operator valued measure. And the statistical meaning of such generalized measurement is that it can be realized as quantum randomized, or as they call, unsharp observable. By Nyman extension, it can be extended to spectral measure of a usual Hermitian operator, but in a larger Hilbert space. What is quite surprising is that such quantum randomized observable can be more informative than any sharp usual observable due to entanglement with randomizer. This is not quite obvious and doesn't have quantum analog. Nevertheless, the inequality is valid. Now it comes the question to define the capacity of classical quantum channel for transmitting classical information. Assume that we can use the channel many times and we want to transmit words of the our alphabet, then we make classical encoding in the input. And first, let us make product decoding, non-entanglement decoding at the output of each use of this channel. Then this picture is a very simple generalization of Shannon coding theorem. It is just you have only freedom to choosing this measurement at the output. And by using Shannon noisy channel coding theorem, it is not difficult to show that the capacity when n goes to infinity of such a channel is given by this expression, maximum of mutual information for one use of the channel over probability distribution of inputs and over measurements at the output of the channel. But this is not genuinely quantum capacity. This is obtained in operational way as follows. Again, we have a classical encoding because we have classical inputs here, but here we can make arbitrary measurement, which does not reduce in any sense to tensor product, entangled decoding. Then we can define error probability for such a scheme in the usual way, and we can define the full classical capacity as supremum of rates. Rate is just exponent in the number of messages. When minimum of error probability goes to zero, minimum over all possible encodings and all possible entangled decodings when n goes to infinity. Of course, it is operational definition, but one would like to have an expression. And the expression is given by this formula, which is usually called Holleover-Schumacher-Westmoreland theorem. We proved it independently and almost simultaneously. And you see, this is classical capacity, according to this theorem, is equal to maximum over all probability distributions of that expression, which appears in the right side of the H inequality. And here appears a new quantum phenomenon, super-additivity of Shannon capacity. If you define Shannon mutual information for n users of channels, it appears that this, unlike the classical case, may be greater, strictly greater, than n by capacity for one use, Shannon capacity for one use. And even in the limit, it can be greater than, so the full quantum capacity of CQ channel can be strictly greater than Shannon capacity of this channel. And this happens generically when the output states of the channel do not commute, so when the channel is essentially quantum. And of course, this is due to possibility of entangled decodings at the output of the channel. So you allow non-product measurement at the output of the channel. Now I will briefly list some results, starting with the original proof. Weak converse of this theorem is proved by using this H-bound inequality and classical Fanon inequality, while direct statement is based on quantum generalization of typicality, notion of typical subspace, asymptotic stochastic matrix analysis. And what is important, there is no maximal likelihood decoding rule. Instead, one should use some purely quantum measurements. In this proof, it was suboptimal decoding, so-called square root measurement, which was introduced by myself earlier. And later, this suboptimal decoding was simplified considerably by Giovannetti Lloyd McConey, who suggested sequential decoding, and Wiley Kucha, who suggested quantum analog of polar codes. I would like also to mention work of Hayashi Nagaoka, Agawa Nagaoka, who gave different proof of the HSW theorem based on binary hypothesis testing and quantum Stein lemma. And they were able to generalize it to quantum generalization of information spectrum approach of Han and Verdu. There was an important work of Wang and Renner on non-asymptotic approach and epsilon one-shot capacity in quantum case. And recent work of Thomas Michel and Tan, who were able to find second-order asymptotic in quantum information theory following the important development in classical information theory by Hayashi and Polyansky, Poor and Verdu. Who suggested finite block length approach in classical information theory. Now, this is about the proof of the theorem and the generalizations. Then one can study reliability function for classical quantum channel, and random coding bound, which is lower bound, was obtained for pure state channel in our joint work with Burnashev rather early, but surprisingly for non-pure state channel, the problem still is open, to my knowledge. There is no proof of this inequality in the case when the signal states, output signal states, are density matrices different from pure states. For Gaussian channels, pure state channel, it was computed concretely in our paper jointly with Soma and Hirota. And important new results appeared in the work of Dalai, who found upper bound, which is quantum analog of Shannon-Gallagher-Bellé-Camp sphere packing, where here is maximum over S greater than zero and inequality is the opposite side, which of course leads to exact value of reliability function for high rates. Also, Dalai found connection between zero error capacity of classical channel and sphere packing for classical quantum channel, which is rather amazing. So apparently a classical object and classically quantum are somehow mysteriously related. And the third topic concerning classical quantum channel is, which was active also recently, is strong converse exponent by Winter following classical work of Avovitz, Agawa Nagaoka following classical work of Arimoto, and then with the smooth entropy approach of Data, Mosini, Xieg, Brandao, Mosini and Agawa, they obtained exact strong converse exponent expressed via sandwiched Renyi divergence, quantum generalization of sandwiched Renyi divergence introduced by Wilder, Winter, Young, Fair, Dupuis, Tuma, Michel. So it's a beautiful formula, and I think study of such quantities is very active now, and I think it will continue at the following conference beyond IID just after ESIT. Now I finish with classical quantum channel and discuss the concept of quantum channel in general. What is should be quantum channel? It should be some mapping which sends input states, density matrices, in output density matrices. And it should send in linear, or better to say, affine way to preserve mixtures of states. Therefore, at least channel should be linear, positive, trace-preserving map to fulfill this requirement. However, one should impose more strong condition. It should be not only positive, but completely positive, which means that a trivial extension of the channel by a parallel ideal channel of arbitrary dimension should be again positive. It may look that it should always be the case, but it is not. There are positive maps which are not completely positive. So it's a very important restriction. Moreover, it gives first insight into mathematical structure of the channel, which I will demonstrate now. And also it leads to nice physical interpretation of a noisy quantum channel. First about mathematical structure. There is an old Steinspring theorem in theory of sister algebras, which in our most concrete case says that for any quantum channel from input to output, there is isometric map from input to the tensor product of output and another system, which is called environment. So this is input system, output system, environment. And the output is given by partial trace over environment of the image of the input state under this isometrical map. In a moment, I will show a physical interpretation of this nice formula. But if you write trace as a sum, one obtains what is called Choi-Kraus representation, very concrete form of completely positive map. So every channel can be represented as such a sum where Vj are linear operators satisfying this normalization condition. This is most general form. But now let us come back to this formula and notice that arbitrary isometry can be extended to a unitary operator in a larger Hilbert space. Then we have the following picture. We have system. For simplicity, it may be input and output. Assume that input equals to output, A equal to B. And then we have environment E. They interact, the environment is initially in some fixed state, and system in arbitrary state S. Then they interact via unitary U, and then we average out the environment. And we obtain the evolution of the open system, what is called quantum open system interacting with the environment. This is just the formula, which is a direct consequence of Steinspring theorem. This is a description of quantum channels. And I must notice that both CQ, classical quantum channels, and quantum classical channels, they fit perfectly in this description, maybe not quite obviously. They are completely positive map, so they satisfy the definition. Now, about the classical capacity of general quantum channel. Again, assume that we can use many times independently the quantum channel phi, and we want to transmit classical information, a number of classical messages where r is rate. Then we make first classical quantum encoding, which sends a word into a density operator in its product input space, depending on the word to be sent. And at the input, we make a decoding, that is measurement, which sends the output state of this product channel into some value, classical value. Then we can compute error probability and again define the classical capacity of quantum channel phi by the same formula, almost the same formula. It is supremum of rates under optimal choice of encoding and decoding when error probability goes to zero as number of uses of channel goes to infinity. And by using HSW theorem for classical quantum channels, it is possible to prove that this operationally defined classical capacity is equal to this regularized expression. This is a limit of C chi of product channel to the degree of n divided by n, where C chi is the so-called chi capacity. This is the expression. This is just maximum over all input ensembles of states. So you take states Sx with probabilities Px, and then you compute this quantity which already appeared, but you use output states. This is output entropy of the channel, and this is just conditional output entropy of the channel phi. If we were so lucky that chi capacity would be additive, satisfying this equality, then we would have a result similar to Shannon noisy channel coding theorem, and no limit here, just this equality. And this question remained for more than 10 years. It turned out very mathematically involved. Finally, in the work of Winter, Hayden and Hastings, it was shown that this does not hold in general. There exist channels, quantum channels, for which the full classical capacity is greater than chi capacity. So we have rather, yes, and the interpretation of this fact is the following. It's not difficult to understand that chi capacity can be defined similarly to the full capacity with the restriction that we use non-entangled encoding. So entanglement is not allowed between different uses of the quantum channel. And this restriction, it leads that this quantity may be, apparently it is less or equal than full capacity, but in some cases it can lead to strict inequality. Well, but the situation is not that simple, because still there is no concrete example of this superadditivity. In fact, the situation with superadditivity is the following. We have seen that superadditivity due to entangled decoding at the output of channel is generic even for classical quantum channel with non-commuting output states, and it is notable, gives notable gain in transmission rate. What concerns superadditivity due to entangled encodings, it is quite difficult to detect. So I said about this work of Winter, Hayden, and Hastings, but their proof was of non-constructive nature. They made just random selection of channels and states and proved then in very high dimensions asymptotically such a non-additive channel exists with probability going to one. But the dimensions are so high that it was not possible, to my knowledge, to construct any explicit example violating this, demonstrating this inequality. On the other hand, there is a whole bunch of channels which enjoy the additivity property. And I will list, this is an incomplete list of the channels for which the additivity property for the classical capacity holds, and thus we have equality between the full capacity and chi capacity. So we can compute actually this capacity. Of course, these are classical channels, obviously. Then it's always not easy to prove. King proved that it holds also for qubit unital channels, which are non-commutative analog of binary bistochastic channels. Also, he proved it for depolarizing channel, which is non-commutative analog of completely symmetric channel in classical information theory. Then I proved it for classical quantum, quantum classical channels, and Peter Shor generalized it to very important class of entanglement breaking channels. These are channels which have quantum channels which have classical processing stage inside between. And also the conjugate of this channel, of which I will not speak, it's also interesting dephasing channels. And finally, a recent result about additivity of classical capacity concerns bosonic Gaussian channels, quantum analog of Gaussian channels. These are channels which operate in infinite dimensions, so I have to be not quite rigorous in what I will say. And this is a result of Giovannetti, myself, and Garcia Patron. It was possible not only to prove additivity, but also to compute the classical capacity to obtain quantum analog of Shannon capacity formula for large class of quantum Gaussian channels. Now I will describe what are quantum Gaussian channels. First, I will describe what is quantization of a classical system. Assume that we have a classical system like several modes of electromagnetic field in a cavity. So usually it is described by what is called symplectic space. For concreteness, finite dimensional symplectic space is just real even dimensional space where S is number of modes in the case of field, and equipped not with inner product, but with this Q-symmetric form or form which is given by such a Q-symmetric matrix. I will call it commutation matrix. So it describes duality between position and moment of the classical system. Now, the quantization of such a system is given by what is called Weil system in a Hilbert space. This is just family of unitary operators in a Hilbert space which satisfies the canonical commutation relation. So you see this is an interchange in the order, and there is this exponent which involves this commutation matrix. Here X are generators, Weierstone theorem of these exponents. And usually they have form several couples of positions and momenta. And in electrodynamics, these are just field quadratures of the quantum electromagnetic field. This is just rigorous way to describe Heisenberg commutation relation in terms of these operators. It is more convenient because it involves unitary bounded operators and not unbounded self-adjoint operators X. But X are basic observables which describe the quantum system. Now the equation for quantum additive Gaussian noise channel, input-output equation, can be written in the way very similar to the classical case. We have classical signal, which is a collection of operators arising from canonical commutation relations, satisfying the canonical commutation relations. They are subject to this matrix gain transformation, and then we add the noise, which is also collection of self-adjoint operators satisfying canonical commutation relation, and it is in a quantum Gaussian state, which I will explain in a moment. So there are two parameters for the channel, matrix parameters, K and mu, gain and noise, and in more rigorous way, you can describe the Gaussian channel equation as a transformation of the exponents, well, exponents in this form. What is important that parameters of quantum Gaussian channels are related by this inequality, which is necessary and sufficient for complete positivity of the channel. Now about Gaussian state. Gaussian state with mean M and covariance matrix alpha is given by quantum characteristic function, which has the same form as the classical Gaussian characteristic function, with the exception that covariance matrix should satisfy this inequality expressing uncertainty relation. And the pure states are obtained when these are minimal solutions of this equation. Alpha are minimal solutions. They necessarily have the form delta J divided by 2, where J is what is called complex structure in the symplectic space. That is operator satisfying these two conditions. So it's like imaginary generalization of imaginary unit. And for fixed complex structure, these are what are called J coherent states. And when M is equal to zero, this is J vacuum state. And the last notion I need to introduce to formulate theorem is J covariant or contravariant Gaussian channel with parameters K and mu. So it is covariant if matrix parameters commute with complex structure, and contravariant if K anti-commutes with the complex structure. And concerning the capacity of quantum Gaussian channels, there were two long-standing conjectures. First, people conjecture that quantum Gaussian channel should have Gaussian optimal encodings and decodings. And second, the additivity of which I already spoke. A starting point is just this simple inequality, which appears from the definition of chi capacity. And it turns out that in the Gaussian case, it's possible to prove that it is equality, which reduces the question about capacity to the question of minimal output entropy. Then we ask whether minimal output entropy of quantum Gaussian channel have Gaussian optimal state, which minimizes, and if it is additive under parallel use of channels. There were two special cases, which probably I have to skip because of the lack of time. This is a case of classical quantum channel and pure loss channel when this is just equal to zero. Then it's not difficult to prove these conjectures. But in general, optimality of Gaussian inputs and additivity of the minimal output entropy were proven for J-covariant and J-contravariant bosonic Gaussian channel for fixed complex structure. And this allowed to show that the classical capacity of these channels is additive, is achieved by Gaussian encoding. And this allowed to write explicit formulas for capacity of the most usable quantum Gaussian channels. These are works of Giovannetti, myself, Garcia Patron, and Marie Giovannetti, and myself. Phase insensitive is physical name for this J-covariant or J-contravariant. However, I would like to mention that the Gaussian optimizer conjecture remains open for general bosonic Gaussian channel without this assumption of J covariance or J contravariance. It's still not solved. Now, this is basic majorization theorem which, from which everything follows. It says that if we have J covariant or contravariant channel and real concave function f, then such a function, we take this trace of function of the output state, it is minimized on coherent states, always on all coherent states. And this value is equal for all coherent states. Equivalently, this means by a version of Karamata theorem, then whenever you input some state to the quantum Gaussian channel, satisfying this condition, the sequence of eigenvalues of the output density operator majorizes in the sense of majorization sequence of eigenvalues of the output density operator for arbitrary state. So they are coherent inputs produce the least chaotic outputs for phase insensitive quantum Gaussian channel. This is a physical interpretation. And then you can compute minimal output entropy just taking entropy function you get this expression for the minimal output entropy where J is important function expressing entropy of quantum Gaussian state. And additivity of minimal output entropy follows from multiplicativity of the vacuum state. One can have similar result for any entropies, but I have no time. And finally, this is the expression for energy constrained classical capacity of quantum channel. First maximum is a kind of quantum water filling problem, which can be solved by convex programming methods, and this is the value of minimal output entropy, which I demonstrated on previous slide. And the optimal encoding consists of coherent states distributed with J-invariant Gaussian probability distribution. Recently it was generalized to squeezed complex structure, this, corresponding to so-called squeezed Gaussian states, and also applied to the practical computation of classical capacity of thermal memory channel by De Palma, Marie Giovannetti, and linear time invariant bosonical channels by Barhan and Shapiro. So I have maybe 1 minute, but there was a movie, so maybe you, can you give me 2 minutes more? Okay, thank you. This is just something concrete. This red curve is the classical capacity of one mode quantum Gaussian channel as a function of this parameter which describes gain. So k less than one means attenuation k greater than one means amplification. But here you can see also three other quantities, entanglement-assisted classical capacity, private classical capacity, and quantum capacity, and I am just going to give a very brief comment about this. So far I spoke about unassisted classical capacity of quantum channel. If one has a possibility of distribute entangled state between input and output, then classical capacity increases, and it can increase dramatically, as it was shown by Bennett, Shor, Smolin, and Tapliel. Moreover, it is given by nice entropic formula, which I do not go into, but it is additive, no additivity problem for it. Next important capacity is quantum capacity. It is just capacity for transmitting not classical information, but quantum states themselves. Quantum state is quantum information. So the formula for this was obtained in the consecutive papers of Lloyd, Shor, Divitak, and also Barnum, Nielsen, Schumacher proved converse theorem. It is very non-additive. It displays extreme form of superadditivity due to Smith and Yard. There are concrete examples of quantum channels which have zero, both have zero quantum capacity, but used in parallel, they have positive quantum capacity. And related is private classical capacity, which was developed by Divitak and Kai Winter Jung. It is also non-additive. So these four capacities, unassisted classical, entanglement-assisted classical, private classical, and quantum, are just basic in the whole variety of quantum channel capacity assisted with other resources, such as forward or backward communication, shared randomness or entanglement. And the relation between them was established in a work of Bennett, Divitak, Shor, and Smolin. Here, inequality means that this quantity is always less or equal than that, but sometimes it can be strictly less. And a unifying mother protocol for all this zoo of capacities was proposed by Abiezinghe, Divitak, Haydn, and Winder some time ago. And here is a very selected list of reference of which I was basing my talk. And also you can address to my book, which was published recently. It has much more detail about what I have said. Thank you.
Questions for Professor Hlevo? Okay. Yes, right there.
If I understand you, quantum Gaussian channels are very common in optical communications, although they don't exhaust, of course, all interesting examples, because some interesting effect does not appear, for example, superadditivity. And also in quantum computation, some operations cannot be fulfilled with Gaussian channels. But still, they are as basic in quantum information theory as in classical information theory.
So Shannon theory evolved from a mathematical theory to a lot of insight into building practical systems. Is there any evolution of these capacity results to an actual quantum communication system?
Maybe you can interpret. My English is not as good.
Is there any progress towards implementing this in practice, quantum computational?
Yes. You see, as I my talk started from understanding quantum limits. So, practical optical quantum channels, they suffer from limitations. So this capacity results. They just give you absolute bounds which cannot be superseded by any efforts. And the question of constructing, for example, entanglement-assisted capacity, this depends whether you can distribute entanglement on long distance. So experimenters report that they can distribute between two islands of distance of 130 kilometers, probably, Zeilinger. But this is, I am theoretician. Hopefully, it will progress, and entanglement-assisted capacity will be also a useful practical tool, not only theoretical construct.
All right. So my question is maybe more in the direction of the very first one on the role of these Gaussian bosonic channels. So they are the quantized linear noise that we are familiar from the Shannon theory. But in nowadays people talk a lot about nonlinear effects in optical communication. So can you comment a bit on nonlinearity in these bosonic channels?
Yes, I think your question is related to the first question. I can just say there is an open way to study perturbation, for example, of quantum Gaussian channels and see what nonlinear effects can arise. But this was not a subject of my talk.
Questions? Okay, so if there are no further questions, then let's thank Professor Oliver first of all for his groundbreaking, just one second, first for his groundbreaking work and also for disentangling for us some of the vast parallel world of quantum communication. Thank you very much.